Sunday for such a scientific fest. Before I embark on the main topic, I like to give you a glimpse of what am I going to talk and navigate on this topic. So these are the major causes of fertility in the couples: unexplained male factors, ovulatory dysfunctions, and of course the others. And here the four main causes of bad ovulation being hypogonadotrophic hypogonadism, PCOS, hyperprolactinemia, and primary ovarian insufficiency or premature ovarian failure. Among the causes of anovulation or disovulation which are amenable to treatment and where you can use this ovulation inducing agents being the cause in hypothalamus, then pituitary, there might be deficiency of GnRH analog, the hormone, stress, as we know, bulimia, anorexia nervosa disorder, stress, idiopathic, where the central factory is deficient. Then comes the pituitary. Pituitary, the causes may be you have a surgery, radiotherapy, panhypopituitarism, Sheehan's, and of course the hyperprolactinemia. Ovarian causes, as I told, commonest being polycystic ovarian syndrome. Other endocrine disorders being hypothyroidism and congenital adrenal hyperplasia. These are the causes which are amenable to treatment with ovulation inducing agents. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia, where there is a deficiency of 21 hydroxylase and they are genotypically females, but phenotypically you have a male factor. Causes of anovulation, which is not amenable to treatment, includes ovarian failure, primary ovarian insufficiency or premature ovarian failure. Cause may be idiopathic, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, surgical removal, and genetic and autoimmune. Chromosomal disorders include Turner's and androgen insensitivity syndrome, where there is being deficiency of 5-alpha-hydroxyreductase that leads to genotypically male but phenotypically females. Now, what are the goals? Goals of ovulation induction: monofollicular rather than multifollicular, monoovulation, having a single pregnancy and a healthy baby birth. What are the general principles? The principles of ovulation induction depends with the clinician has to choose, depends on the underlying cause of anovulation, efficacy, risk, cost effectiveness, minimal patient burden, and the complication of each drug depends on the patient's compliance and its clinical history. So my dear friends, it's very important to be clinically strong, go through all the old papers. Whenever the patient comes to our clinic, you don't know how many cycles drug and what are the treatments patient has undergone. So that will be your main stem of successful pregnancy outcome. What is the ideal ovulation inducing drugs? It should be orally effective, minimal monitoring required, no hostile effect on endometrium, cervix, and should have a better comparison between ovulation and pregnancy rate. Of course, less risk of multiple pregnancy and OHS, which is one of the gradient complications. What are the ovarian, what are the different protocols and the main pharmaceutical agents which are available for ovulation induction? Gonadotropins, first of all, clomiphene, letrozole, combination of clomiphene, letrozole with gonadotropins, gonadotropins alone, and combination with antibodies. Now, how we pipeline this ovarian stimulation in IUI cycle? As we have already discussed the physiology, the main aim is to increase the FSH above the threshold and should remain above threshold for a little bit in a longer period of time. Why? That is called the window period. Why? So that you have got the follicle recruitment and finally one, two follicles becoming dominant. Now, what are the side effects of this? Because once you have a many follicles being recruited, you have an increased estradiol. This causes premature alert surge, and how you can tackle this? By giving few days antagonist, which I prefer. Now, this is a basic, you can see how the recruitment and finally the dominance, and finally you have a trigger, and that is the ovulation. The first line of drug being clomiphene, which has stood the test of time for almost decades. Why? Because it's orally effective, cost effective, minimal monitoring and complications. Now what it is? It is actually an estrogen receptor blocker in the central level, hypothalamus and pituitary. So what happens is that It causes increased secretion of FSH and which in turn leads to development of follicles. But the main drawback of clomiphene being anti-estrogenic effect. How to start clomiphene? The start you can, it is an initial choice. You can start from 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th day, any time. And it gives all the randomized control studies saying the same result. And what is the dosage? Dosage from 50 to 150 mg, it all again depends how you increase. You can increase every time 50 mg, but in clinical practice, low dose gives much better result. High dose will have more anti-estrogenic effect and more complications. So if you have to have a success, 3 cycles with 50 mg, believe me, gives good result if the result has to come. But it has been recommended by SRM, you can continue till 6 to 12 cycles. Now, what is clomiphene failure and clomiphene resistance? You are giving a very good doses of clomiphene, but still no ovulation. You are saying no signs of ovulation. That is called clomiphene resistant. But in spite of having a good ovulation, good development of dominant follicle, you are going fine, but patient fails to conceive. That is nothing but a clomiphene failure. So when to stop clomiphene? You have given an adequate treatment, adequate cycles, but still patient fails to conceive. It's time to stop, otherwise you will lose your patient and patients who have infertility goes on moving from one to the other.